We have loved him as the TV vet, tackling all sorts of animal issues. But now Dr. Chris Brown is prescribing pets for the nation's health. Let's welcome him back to Studio 10 with some furry friends. How are you?
I'm really well, thank you. It's good to see you guys. And nice to see, Jess in a natural environment. Oh.
Right? Yeah. I'm in heaven.
You see, Sarah, who loves ginger cats, I'm getting into cats. Mm. She wanted to hold this and I went, no, sorry. Mm. I have to hold it.
There we go.
And this is little Simba. Cats, though, they do, and Nancy agrees, they make you just feel good and happy, don't they?
They do. And again, research is showing across the board that pets, really, no matter what they are, make us happier, make us healthier across all ages. So kids have better immunity, they have fewer ear infections, they need antibiotics more rarely. Then growing up, it teaches kids empathy. Adults are healthier, they have lower blood pressure. They meet other adults, if you know what I mean, a little bit more easily.
Right. Hanging out down in the dog park. Yeah.
And then through to old age, pets are a great way of reducing loneliness and requiring a doctor less. So what we found is, for the first time, we've actually been able to quantify the health benefits of pets in Australia.
Mm. So how do you do that?
Well, you look at how many times that pet owners go to the doctor compared to non-pet owners, and pet owners go to the doctor far less than non-pet owners.
So I'm with you.
Yeah.
Completely.
So what we found is that through having pets in our nation, having a whole lot of households across the country that have pets, we're actually saving $2 billion in our health budget every single year.
Wow.
And you want politicians to do something about this, don't you?
Well, ideally, yeah. I mean, the whole idea is that if we give a little to get a little, and if we start to appreciate the fact that pets are hugely beneficial to our health and to our health budget, then what we're going to find is if we can actually encourage people to have pets and just increase pet ownership by say, 10%, across the country, then these health benefits flow right through.
So are you talking about perhaps rebates for pet owners?
Yeah, I mean, we do it in a lot of different areas. So in the same way as we had a bit of a baby bonus, we have a fur baby bonus. So all we're talking about is potentially a tax credit for $100.
So I would like to see it go to pensioners so that they can afford to have a pet.
Yeah, and the idea would be that it just gives that little bit of extra bonus and helps you through, say, the vaccination or the microchipping.
So the government would actually pay you $100 or give you $100 off your tax or whatever to
own
for
a
you
pet.
To go out and buy a pet.
Absolutely. So just that little kicker. Obviously, you want to be responsible. You want to make sure that the right people are still adopting a pet. But for those families that might be thinking about it, might just need a little bit of a push in the right direction, it's a really, really good way that they can do that.
And has the government, have you spoken to anyone in the government? Have they given you any idea whether they might be?
We're talking. Yeah, so we've actually got a few meetings.
How could they say no to you,
exactly.
Dr. Brown? But it's interesting, though, isn't it? Because at this time, we're sort of being told to tighten our belts that, you know, we've got to reduce spending. Do you think this is something they might go for?
Well, it's actually going to save money.
Yeah.
So if you look at how much money's already being saved across the country by doing this, if you can just increase the pet population just a little bit, then you actually do stand to save our health budgets. Our health budgets are already, you know, being clamped down upon. But as Trump says, we've got a great healthcare system. He'd love to have our healthcare system. But why not make it a little bit better?
That's right. And Donald Trump's right about everything.
Absolutely.
Can I ask you about what is the weirdest pet you've ever had in the surgery or had to go and visit and fix?
Well, there's quite a few. I've been asked to go and treat an eel.
Eel?
Yeah, you know how every kid wants to adopt some particular pet.
An eel?
Yeah, I had a kid that brought in their pet spider. And the parents were like, oh, look, just go along with it. You know, he's happy. And the kid had adopted a redback spider. And I was like, I think probably this one just needs to spend some time at the vet clinic. He's going to have a little holiday with us. We're going to de-sex him. Microchip him. We're going to do all the things we need to.
It'd be very difficult to de-sex a spider, wouldn't it?
So he did.
Did the spider go to live with grandma and grandpa up at the farm?
He went to the reptile park to have a little holiday.
Now, our gorgeous home viewer, Maddie, is listening in on this conversation and she's got something to ask you, Dr. Chris Brown.
Hi, Dr. Brown. My alpaca, you can see behind me, broke her leg when she was only 3 months old. And I was just wondering if that's going to have any effect on her childbearing.
That's a very interesting question. It really shouldn't. I mean, ultimately, in the same way with humans, obviously, with pregnancy, it's mostly retained within. But what you need is the strength in those legs to support the extra weight that's going to come through having a baby alpaca inside you. So
I hear you. I hear you.
Any injuries that you've been concerned about?
No, but I feel like I need very strong legs at the moment. It's a lot to carry.
And that's the idea. So provided that the leg is not causing any lameness and not causing any issues right now. And looking at them, they're looking very, very fine.
They look fabulous.
They're not looking like they're struggling whatsoever.
I'm not really sure how alpacas do it, but would the legs, would a broken leg or anything stop them from doing the thing that gets them pregnant?
Well, Joe, without going into diagrams or reenactments, the female simply stands there. While the male takes on most of the work.
It's a lot like my marriage.
These pussycats are so divine.
They are.
That we're holding, and they're looking for homes.
Yeah.
So I've got little Simba here. I'd like to take Simba home.
You'll get killed.
How do you think Violet would go with that?
She'd be okay, but I think my husband would divorce me. He's already said if there's a fourth cat in the house, that's it. But well, so they're all looking for homes.
They are. They're from Pet Rescue. So these guys, if you're wondering
what...
They're pretty fidgety. Obviously, it's a new experience for them being in a studio. But also, they were former strays. So this is sort of the work in action here. These guys have come from a place where they'd never really had any chance of having a home, and they've had to be conditioned to the idea of pets and affection and love, but they've come a long way.
They're beautiful.
And, you know, for them to be...
They're very furry.
They are. No. They're a bit man-coonish.
A little mush.
We might hold the applause or have little golf claps just so we don't terrify the
cats.
We've got to thank the wonderful people at the Community Cat Carers of Sydney for bringing these gorgeous kittens in. All three, as Jess mentioned, are looking for forever homes. So if you'd like to get in touch, we'll put the website on our Facebook page. Dr. Chris Brown, always lovely seeing
you.
Thank you
very
so much.
Thanks for coming in. Yeah.